Neutrophils, lymphocytes, and monocytes. What's optimal for health and longevity? So neutrophils, lymphocytes, and monocytes are components of white blood cells. So let's take a quick step back and look at the association between total numbers of white blood cells with life expectancy. So what we're looking at here is longitudinal data from the Baltimore Longitudinal Study on Aging with a relatively small sample size compared to what the rest of the studies, data from the studies that I'm going to show you in a slide or two, with about 2,800 subjects. But the strength of this study is that the subjects' data was followed for up to 44 years, so hence the longitudinal study. So for white blood cells, note that the reference range is 3,400 to 10,800 white blood cells per microliter, but the reference range says nothing about what's optimal for health and longevity. So starting from blood test data for subjects in their 50s, life expectancy was then plotted against the initial white blood cell count. So what we can see is that for subjects that had total white blood cell levels of 3,500 to 6,000 cells per microliter, that group had the longest life expectancy, about 37 years, starting from the initial measurement in their 50s. So what about the higher end of the reference range, 6,000 to 10,000 white blood cells per microliter? So this group lived significantly shorter than the 3,500 to 6,000 group, about 7 years shorter. So a 30-year life expectancy, again, starting from the initial measurement for subjects in their 50s. So still within the reference range, but again, towards the highest end of the range, greater than 10,000 cells per microliter, we see a life expectancy of about 27 years. So when comparing the highest end of the reference range, greater than 10,000 white blood cells per microliter, versus the 3,500 to 6,000 white blood cells per microliter, that's about a 10-year difference in life expectancy. So what about less than 3,500 white blood cells per microliter? So this group would appear to have the shortest life expectancy compared to all the other groups, but there were only 49 subjects in that group that had less than 3,500. So the authors couldn't properly statistically determine if that was associated with a reduced life expectancy compared to all the other groups. All right, so white blood cells are not all the same, though. There are many different cell types. And these cell types include neutrophils, eosinophils, monocytes, basophils, and lymphocytes. Now, because neutrophils, lymphocytes, and monocytes comprise 99%, around 99% of the total white blood cell content, that I'm going to go over that data today in terms of what's optimal for health and longevity. So first, starting for neutrophils. So the reference range is very wide, 1,400 to 7,000 neutrophils per microliter. So again, within that range, what's optimal? So first, in looking at the aging data, this is data for about 378,000 subjects, so a relatively large study. So the data for men is shown in green, and this is relatively easy and straightforward. So neutrophils increase pretty consistently during aging for men, and this is from about 20 years old through 90 years old. As you can see, the green line consistently increases throughout the lifespan for men. For women, the story is a little bit more complicated. We see that neutrophils increase from about 5,000 neutrophils per microliter in women up to about 6,500 in their mid-30s, and then neutrophils decline all the way until the mid-50s, and then they increase again until 90. So what could explain this biphasic plot for women? So one explanation may involve pregnancy. So as we can see here, pregnant women versus non-pregnant women and the neutrophil levels. So what we can see is that pregnant women have higher average neutrophil levels than non-pregnant women. In this case, about 5,300 in the pregnant women versus about 4,100 in the non-pregnant women. And these two groups of data were significantly different. So my explanation for the plot for women, how neutrophils change during aging, is that compared to 20-year-olds, there's probably an increased proportion of pregnant women in this cohort, so that their neutrophil levels up to about 35 are higher than the proportion of women who are less pregnant at 20. And then the frequency of women who are pregnant from 35 to 55 decreases compared to the 20 to 35 group, thereby explaining the decrease in neutrophils during that age. And then obviously post-menopause, there isn't going to be any pregnancy, so then we see the rise in neutrophils in a similar pattern to men. Now, Based on the aging data, this would suggest that values of around in the 4,000s, 4,000 to 5,000, would be indicative of youth for neutrophils for both men and women. But lower may be better. And in support of that hypothesis, we're looking at all-cause mortality data in a very large study, more than 775,000 subjects. And what we can see is compared to the 2,000 to 3,000 neutrophil group, which was used as the reference, subjects that had neutrophil counts that were less than 2,000 and greater than 3,000 had a significantly increased all-cause mortality risk when compared to 2,000 to 3,000. So based on this data, I'd argue that 2,000 to 3,000 may be optimal in terms of neutrophil levels during aging and for their association for their lowest risk of death for all causes. All right, so what about lymphocytes? So the reference range is 700 to 3100, and these reference range values can vary from lab to lab. These are the lab values that are on my blood test results that come from LabCorp. So for lymphocytes, that reference range is 700 to 3100. Again, a pretty wide range that says nothing about what's optimal. It's just a population-based average. So what does the data have to say for lymphocytes? So first, we're looking at lymphocyte levels on the y-axis, again, plotted versus age. So age-related changes for lymphocytes. And what we can see is that youth, subjects around 20 years old, are characterized by higher lymphocytes, whereas lymphocytes then decline, as indicated by the black trend line, all the way up to 100-year-old subjects. So what about all-cause mortality risk? So similarly, we can see that values of around 2, so somewhere in the 1900 to 2100 lymphocytes per microliter, was associated with lowest all-cause mortality risk. And I should mention in this study, it's relatively large, about 108,000 subjects. And then that data is shown on the left slide, the age-related changes. Also note that although the proportion of the variance in the lymphocyte count that can be explained by age, the R-squared, is relatively small at 0.07, that lymphocytes decline during aging was a consistent effect, which would explain why the small explanation in variance is statistically significant with a p-value less than 0.001. So again, going back to the all-cause mortality data, we can see lymphocyte levels 1900 to about 2100. Lymphocytes per microliter was associated with the lowest risk of death for all causes. And then significantly increased risk, so values that for the 95% confidence interval, so the dashed lines, where they both pass one, where they don't intersect with one, we can see that values less than 1900 lymphocytes per microliter are associated with a significantly increased all-cause mortality risk. Now also note that higher levels of lymphocytes, greater than about 3,000, is also associated with an increased all-cause mortality risk. But just to compare, someone who has less than 1,000 versus someone who has 3,000, the all-cause mortality risk for someone who has 1,000 lymphocytes is greater than someone with 3,000, at least based on the data that's presented here. So having lower lymphocytes is potentially going to be worse for risk of death for all causes versus a slightly elevated or moderately elevated lymphocyte count. So based on these data, somewhere around 2,000 lymphocytes per microliter in the 1900 to 2100 range may be optimal. All right, what about monocytes? So again, the reference range is 100 to 900 cells per microliter. So what's optimal? So first, looking at the age-related changes, we see a similar plot to the neutrophil data, a pretty steady increase for men in the green line from 20 to 90 years old. And again, this biphasic response in women with an increase from 20 to about 35, a decrease from 35 to 55, and then again in a very steady increase in monocytes all the way up to 90. So again, as a potential explanation for the biphasic plot for monocytes in women, we can see that again, pregnancy impacts monocyte levels. So this is data looking at the trimesters, so going from the first 3 months to second 3 months to the last 3 months of pregnancy, first, second, and third trimester. And looking at monocyte counts for each of those periods during pregnancy. So what we can see is in the data that they presented, the average data is not in microliters. So to get it into the normalize it to microliters, not liters, you multiply by 1,000. So 0.49 times 1,000. So 490 monocytes per microliter in the first trimester, increased to 530 in the second, and up to 620 in the third trimester. And the difference between those three groups is statistically significant, as indicated by the p-value. So we can see that monocyte levels increase during pregnancy in women. So again, that would potentially explain the biphasic response. A greater proportion of women are pregnant up to about 35 when compared to 20-year-olds. That would explain the monocyte increase during that time. A lower frequency of women from 35 to 55 compared to the 20 to 35 group, hence the declining monocyte levels. And then, again, an age-related postmenopausal increase is exhibited from 60 to 90 years for monocytes. All right, what about all-cause mortality data? And I should mention that based on the aging data, it looks like 530 and 550 monocytes in women and men, respectively, may be optimal or indicative of youth, but lower than that may be optimal. And we can assess that by looking at all-cause mortality risk. So all-cause mortality risk is sometimes presented as cardiovascular disease, CVD mortality, and then non-CVD mortality. So all the other deaths that are not related to cardiovascular disease. So that's how I'm going to present it here. And what we can see from these plots, which are hazard ratios, again, so survival, we can see lowest risk of all-cause mortality. So the lowest point in the data occurs for both CVD mortality and non-CVD mortality at about 400 monocytes in both plots per microliter. So that would suggest around 400 may be optimum for lowest risk of death for all causes, CVD and non-CVD related mortality. What about higher risk? So this occurs where the 95% confidence interval, the dashed lines in both plots, do not intersect with 1.0, which I've indicated by the red line. So we can see that for the CVD mortality risk, there's increasing risk less than about 250 and greater than around 400 monocytes per microliter for cardiovascular disease-related mortality. What about non-cardiovascular disease-related mortality on the right? So a relatively similar data here. We can see that less than 400 and about greater than 550 is associated with an increased non-CVD mortality risk of death. All right, so in my initial slide, I showed the data from the Baltimore Longitudinal Study on Aging that showed longest life expectancy starting from baseline data in around the 50s for 3,500 to 6,000 white blood cells per microliter. But based on the data that I've presented here today, we can get more specific with that 3,500 to 6,000 range in terms of looking at the different white blood cell types that are found. So for neutrophils, based on the data, it would seem that 2,000 to 3,000 cells per microliter is optimal. For lymphocytes, 1,900 to 2,100, and for monocytes, somewhere around 400 monocytes per microliter. So when you sum that, you get a range of 4,300 to 5,500 neutrophils, lymphocytes, and monocytes per microliter, which falls right in that, you know, quote-unquote optimal range for white blood cells of 3,500 to 6,000. Now note that eosinophils and basophils are not included in that projection, but this is a relatively small component of the total white blood cell pool at about only 1%, so that easily gives enough a range to stay within that 6,000 upper limit for total white blood cells. Okay, that's all I've got for now. You can find me lots of places online. Have a great day.